never know how much you love the one you love until it's gone. There's a big part of history here that's going to move to the arena in Brooklyn. But you'll never be able to replace the feel that we had, the closeness. People were part of the game and right on top of you. You could feel the breathing. You could feel their excitement. It was a building that was very boisterous, and we protected it. We protected its integrity. We protected its reputation. You came in this building, and you weren't going to win.
There was nothing here before the Coliseum was built. You look around now and it's surrounded by office buildings and a big hotel, but in those early days, it was barren. It was like going into the barren plains, and suddenly out of nowhere rose Nassau Coliseum.
Constructed on Mitchell Field, home to a former Army and Air Force base, Nassau Veterans Memorial Coliseum opened in February of 1972. That fall, the expansion New York Islanders began play, and the NHL had two New York metropolitan rivals for the first time in three decades.
We had played an exhibition game, the very first game. I remember very clearly the Rangers came out on the ice first, and they got a standing ovation from the crowd. It was a full house. We came out a few minutes later, and it was dead silence.
The first season, right from training camp, it was a little unsettling.
We're an expansion team. We weren't very good. We only won 12 games all year. Set a record for futility.
Right in front, a shot is in just that quickly.
Another shot and the score.
Our first big step to improve this team was to completely redo our defense.
To guide the transformation behind the bench, Torrey selected Al Arbor, a highly decorated defenseman working his way up through the coaching ranks.
I agreed to go to New York, and I remember Scotty Bowman told me, "You're going to be in last place for 10 years. As we'll see."
He was with the program of where we were going with the draft. And we had three very, very good amateur drafts.
I literally asked to be traded from the Philadelphia Flyers. And I remember Keith Allen saying, "Why would you want to go to such a terrible hockey team?" I said, "Well, there's two reasons. One of them, I'll get a chance to play a lot. But the other big reason is because Bill Torrey, their general manager, has been telling everybody that he's going to pick my brother Dennis."
Many teams, including the rival New York Rangers, wanted to acquire Dennis Potvin. But Torrey kept his first overall pick and selected the young defenseman.
I came in to meet Al Arbor. It had been his second or third day on the job. I never met him before. He sat down and said, "Dennis, take a look at this video." And it was a video of the Philadelphia Flyers just hammering the New York Islanders. And I said to Al, "That's not going to happen again."
Training camp, he worked us really hard. He said, "Look, I'm not trying to kill you. We don't have as good a team, we all know that, as many other teams in the NHL. But I will tell you, one way we're never going to lose a hockey game is because the other team's in better physical condition."
We went on to cut down the goals against by 100 that year. I think it may still be an NHL record.
Bill Torrey had picked the players and made the trades that slowly built the nucleus, about five or six guys that were going to be there for hopefully 7 or 8, 9 years.
To supplement that core, Torrey acquired two crucial veterans in trades with Minnesota, J.P. Parisi and Jude Drouin.
75 was a big step. That's where Jude and J.P. were a big piece to educating these kids as to what it takes.
Almost from the time they got there, we started winning, including, naturally, that first series against the Rangers.
After only three seasons, the Islanders had made the playoffs, appropriately as underdogs to their fiercest rivals.
They were a very good hockey team, most likely a cup contender. We must have looked like a bunch of gnats. You know, we were physical, we were aggressive, and I think all in all, we were a pretty determined young hockey team.
The team split the first two games, forcing a series-deciding game 3 at Madison Square Garden.
Al would remind us, "Just go out there and play your game. We can beat anybody if you put your mind to it.
11 seconds into overtime of the elimination game, the Islanders' franchise changed forever.
Let's score! It's over! Parisi!
When JP scored that goal, all of a sudden people thought of us a little bit differently.
We were fighting for our identity. By the time we got to the end of that season, we were respected and feared.
My first game at the Coliseum, I go behind the bench and there's no glass in the back. And I see those five guys sitting there with Ranger sweaters on right in the front row. I said, I thought this was our building here. They were playing the Rangers, they got five guys sitting there and they were pounding me in the back of the head. And I turned around and felt like driving them. I said, I can't do that. So I said to the guy, I said, you gotta put some glass back there because I'm going to get in a lot of trouble.
Hockey's the lifeblood of New York. It's a big part of the daily fabric.
There's nothing like it. When you get behind the bench and you're listening to the fans, let's go Islanders, let's go Rangers. I mean, it's great for the people in New York.
It's comparable to the Boston, Montreal. The fans are, you know, nuts.
They say to you, you know, I don't care if you guys lose every game all year, as long as you beat the Rangers.
It's their pride on the line, not so much just the players' pride.
We had to fight for our place on Long Island and in the NHL.
In the early days, there were a lot of Long Island fans who were really Ranger fans that just wanted to go see hockey games.
The Rangers go down and score, and I see someone jump up, and he has a Rangers jersey on. About 5 minutes later, I'm sitting on the bench, and we go down and score, and I see that same fan get up and take his Ranger jersey off, and he had an Islander jersey on underneath. The team was in the midst of creating a whole new legend of Islander fans.
We were kind of split as far as families go. Parents were usually the Ranger fans, and then the young kids were the Islander fans. And when we won that series, it kind of put us on the map.
Underdogs no more. J.P. Parisi's goal in the 1975 playoffs legitimized the Rangers-Islanders rivalry. In the winter of 1978, Brian Trottier helped cement Long Island's place as an NHL powerhouse.
People asked me who was the best player you played with or played against, and I always use Brian Trottier as my answer.
For 4 to 6 years, he was the best all-around player in the whole world.
One thing that Brian always says about himself is that he didn't have the greatest shot. He didn't have the greatest shot, but who cares? You got to have a pretty good shot to get to 500 goals in the National Hockey League.
No score, 6:52 left in the first. Steve Albert and Stan Fischler from the Nassau Coliseum.
It was just one of those nights where things were going well. That night was my night, and it just, everything I touched was golden.
Coming in. He shoots, he scores! It's 3-1 Islanders.
And I remember looking over at Mike on one faceoff, and I said, we're going forward on this one. Without saying a word, I just looked at him, and he nodded back.
It'll be Dean Talafis against Mike Buddy.
We kind of like looked at each other seriously, not smiling, just because I said, how did you know what I was thinking? And he goes, I don't know.
What a night for Brian Trottier. 4-1 Islanders now.
The Islanders cruised to a 9-4 victory, and Brian Trottier set a franchise record with 8 points. In 1979, the Rangers avenged the Parisi goal, upsetting a Long Island team poised for a deep playoff run. But as a dynasty blossomed, the Blue Shirts were no match for the Islander juggernaut, and Long Island dominated Manhattan from 1981 to 1983. The rivalry climaxed in 1984 during the Islanders' drive for 5 straight Stanley Cups.
We're down to 1 game. The New York Islanders and the New York Rangers in the Battle of New York. Here's a chance for Mossy.
The Coliseum erupted as the Islanders appeared destined for a 4th straight series win over their rivals. But a lucky break changed the momentum during the game's waning moments.
I remember the game and Don Maloney scoring an illegal goal with a high stick.
Patrick got it in front. Smith scores! The Rangers have tied it with 39 seconds to play in regulation time.
jokingly, I'd run and see Donnie Maloney because he played for the Islanders a few years later, and I, of course, told him that was a high stick.
I was on the ice for the game tying goal. You know, as a defenseman, you don't feel too good about that.
Eager to atone for the Maloney goal, the team refocused before overtime.
I'm confident our players have been through this before and they know what has to be done.
That game going into overtime made it where, in many cases, we felt that was our time.
We just always found ways to win hockey games. We were an overtime team. Whenever we needed to score in overtime, we were comfortable.
There wasn't anybody on our team that could feel like they couldn't be the guy.
On that night, the guy would be an Olympic champion who, in front of his former coach, brought some Lake Placid magic to Uniondale.
1980, I went to Lake Placid, and I spent a week watching Kenny Morrow.
Probably the best defensive defenseman I've ever seen.
Kenny Morrow was probably the strongest man that I've ever seen play the sport. I mean, I couldn't even pick up his stick, it was so heavy.
It's all on the line now. Overtime here in Long Island.
Some of the announcers, I believe Bob Cole, called it the greatest overtime ever played.
Can you believe this action in overtime?
One of Al Arbor's biggest attributes is don't sit back, be fast, be quick, but be smart.
Maloney in front, Billy Smith, Rob Book, robbed him.
I don't care who wins this game now. We have had just a tremendous show here tonight.
Kenny Moore had the magic touch. He always found a way to score big goals.
We got the puck back to Kenny, and as soon as you get the puck back to the blue line, you crowd the net.
Pat Flatley, the great screen on the goaltender.
Shot, score!
And my famous, like, 50-mile-an-hour slap shot that somehow made it through.
The Islanders have done it! The Islanders, goal! They have won it in overtime! 3-2, it's over!
Still have Ranger people come up to me telling me how I broke their heart.
The grudge match between us and the Rangers, and if we hadn't won, we wouldn't have been able to live on the island for the summer.
I guess if you're gonna score a goal, a series-winning goal, the Rangers are the team to do it.
A goaltender, I think he was in Minnesota at that time, said that Mike Bossy is the scariest guy when he comes down to shoot on you. He has 10 ways to score on you, and you don't know which one he's going to use.
Mike Bossy in practice played for keeps. He tried to put the puck through the back of the net every time he shot the puck.
I would always ask him, what are you thinking when you go down on your breakaway? And I noticed you go five hole a lot. He said he takes the puck off the heel, and as he's going to shoot it, he tries to turn the puck sideways with the top of his toe. If a puck's going sideways, it might have a chance to squirm its way through, whereas if it's laying horizontal, you have less of a chance. I never would have thought of something like that.
By 1977, the Islanders had established themselves as a defensively strong team in the crease and on the blue line. At the draft, Bill Torrey added the explosive Mike Bossy. Passed over 14 times, the skinny native of Montreal collected staggering goal totals in the Quebec Major Junior League.
It was quite intimidating. I think everyone was expecting, you know, this hotshot kid from Quebec to come in and score goals.
Bossy did just that, scoring 53 goals, a then record for rookies, and found immediate chemistry with center Brian Trottier.
He and I were great teammates, line mates, roommates. That innate quality to read off each other and realize that if I go here, he should be able to get me yeah, and he does. And that worked, and it was kind of fun. We'd be smiling at each other going back to the bench and giggle about it back at the hotel room later.
We probably laughed as much on the ice as we did off the ice. We were just two guys who found a lot of situations very funny.
But the numbers the duo put up were no laughing matter. And in the winter of 1981, Bossy was on the verge of history.
I told my brother-in-law before the season that I think I could do 50 and 50. I wanted to do it.
At the time, scoring 50 goals in 50 games had been accomplished by only one player, Maurice the Rocket Richard.
growing up in Montreal, knowing that the Rocket was revered, he was a legend, and being able to go out there and repeat something that Maurice Richard had done upset a lot of people in Montreal.
There was a couple scary moments where all of a sudden you had the NHL security around. There was a warm-up in Pittsburgh where he was the only guy standing on one side of the ice because we were teasing him before the game that if there's a sniper out there, we don't want to be anywhere getting picked off.
I had 48 and 47, didn't score in 48, didn't score in 49, didn't score in the first two periods of the 50th game. Went into the dressing room after the second period, and I was exhausted mentally and physically.
I've really put a lot of pressure on myself to break this record. I've made it public that I wanted to break this record. You know, if I don't do it, well, then I won't have anybody else to blame but myself.
Boss felt that he was going to get it. He needed two goals that night. He was motivated, driven, and as tough as they come.
With less than 5 minutes remaining and overtime not yet part of the regular season, Bossy found an opening.
There's, you know, power play shot from the point, rebound comes out, I swat at it and it goes in, and then a great forecheck by Brian and Tinelli, then a pass over and I stop the puck.
To Bossy, shoots, he scores! Mike Bossy has his 50th
everyone pouring onto the ice. I remember the Bossy chants in the building.
Bossy had tied the Rocket and recorded at least 50 goals for the fourth straight season, a streak that would eventually end at an NHL record 9 years.
I'll always remember being honored at a banquet. Maurice was there. I remember him taking me in like a headlock, and you know, everyone's saying, oh, that's a funny photo you have with Morris. And I said, you know what? I said, he was semi-serious. He may have thought at the time when he scored 50 and 50 that no one else is going to do that. Like I'm thinking now that, you know, 9 consecutive 50-plus goal seasons, who's going to do that? I may be taking someone in a headlock before I leave this world.
January 21st, 1982. 2 days after my 18th birthday, the Islanders played the Pittsburgh Penguins that night. In fact, they played the Penguins 3 times in the span of a week. That got them jump-started on what became their 15-game winning streak.
On February 20th, 1982, New York sat on the precipice of breaking a 52-year-old NHL record for consecutive regular season wins. Their opponent, the Colorado Rockies, a gritty bunch backstopped by a popular former Islander making his return to the Coliseum, Chico Resch.
This has been pretty emotional, and especially with the Islanders on this streak, you know, I knew there'd be a lot of excitement.
Resch and the Rockies met the home team's every challenge, and the game remained tied deep into the final period.
2-2 tie, the Islander 14-game win streak is on the line. In the last 60 seconds, as Trache goes into center ice. Over the line, in it to Tinelli, shooting, he scores!
We wanted that record. We really did. John Tinelli was probably one of the most tenacious, fierce competitors that you could ever imagine.
There's the story, a 52-year-old record in the National Hockey League has now been broken.
That spring, the Islanders and the Pittsburgh Penguins ended their first-round playoff series with a decisive fifth game at the Coliseum.
First game we hammered them, and then they beat us too, and they were leading 3-1 in the third. Everybody thought it was over.
I was in the penalty box with about 6 minutes left. Jack Rafferty, who was the penalty box attendant, he says, I can't believe it's over. And I said to him, I said, it's not over.
Coach Al Arbour shuffled his goalies to allow his stars to rest. Moments later, Mike McEwen put New York within one, and with time winding down, John Tinelli again took center stage.
If that guy went into the corner, he was coming out with a puck.
What a comeback for the Islanders! Are they over yet?
He played the game like he was a motorized bobblehead doll.
He would just be rocking on the bench like this, just rocking.
I mean, he was always, his shoulders were up and down and his head was weaving back and forth.
It's crazy, man, when he got possessed when he got in the corner with the puck. Him and Nystrom together were horrible to play against, I'm sure.
He would come out of the corners, he'd be kicking the puck along the boards, and just as he'd come out, he'd turn his stick back and whack you right over top of the head.
In overtime, Tinelli and Nystrom went to work.
Oh,
So I'm laying on my back like this, and Johnny T just shoots it over top of me. I watched it go into the net. It was probably one of the biggest goals in Islander history right there.
The Coliseum sort of adopted the name Fort Neverlose, and it's really what it was. Even in the years that we didn't win the Stanley Cup, we were a darn good hockey team. This was our building, and I can't imagine people were thinking it was much fun coming in here.
The Islanders franchise made tremendous strides in the late 70s, but regular season dominance did not mean playoff success.
We had lost a couple of very important playoff series to the Rangers and the year before that to Toronto.
We were so close to winning the Cup those 2 years. The team did just a couple little things. Brian Trottier needed just a little bit more, Mike Bossy just a little bit more, a little maturity.
I thought that they were going to break up the team because, you know, we had a disappointment for 2 years in a row.
Like anything else at the end of the year, I thought about a lot of trades.
We had good draft picks coming. Our farm teams were developing, so I stuck with it.
We were an extremely talented hockey team, best in the NHL, according to regular season standings, but probably a little bit uptight.
In the playoffs, I'd walk in the dressing room, and the guys had their fingers in their mouth and everything else. Oh, my God, what am I going to do? We got to get somebody that's going to relax those players. So that's when we made a trade for Butch Goring.
Butch Goring had played in Los Angeles for several years. We knew he could score, but we didn't realize that he would come into the dressing room and settle us down.
They had struggled for most of the 79-80 season, so it was around the league. There was a buzz, you know, what was going on with this hockey club?
What we didn't know was how we were perceived on the outside.
This team needed to hear that this was a really good hockey team with an awful lot of talent, and I don't think they recognized that.
You just don't think that you're as good as what is needed to win. You tend to take that negative attitude, oh boy, we'll never beat these Flyers, we'll never beat these Bruins, to all of a sudden thinking, here's a guy who's been around the league for a long time, and he's telling us that we're better than these teams.
The addition of Goring and U.S. Olympian Ken Morrow stabilized the 1980 Islanders for the playoff push.
With a long grind, L.A. the first round, Boston the second, Buffalo, and then by the time we got to Philly, I think both teams at that point were pretty beat up.
There was respect on both sides. They were going to play a rough series, but then our power play really negated that totally.
We were a force to be reckoned with, and the Flyers knew that going in. They couldn't get too rambunctious and take stupid penalties because we were going to burn them.
New York's power play sealed game one in overtime, and the Islanders held a 3-2 series lead heading back to the Coliseum for game six.
I hope we don't sound like we're going to be shouting all afternoon, but that's what we might have to do.
The atmosphere was raucous during a back-and-forth first period.
Pick somebody up!
Tied at two in the second, New York broke the stalemate.
I just scored a goal just before we went into the locker room. It made it 4-2.
Crowd stands and cheers. That may be the biggest goal that Bob Nystrom will ever score.
We're high-fiving in the locker room. We're, like, congratulating each other. It kind of turned around pretty quickly.
DuPont shot, deflects, they score!
We thought we had it done. We were pretty good defensively. And then when they tied it up, I mean, we went in after the third period, and it was just like, silence. And then, you know, as always happened in those games, someone yelled out, who's going to be the hero? Everyone in the room said, I am.
There were like eight other guys saying, I'm going to get it, you know, and off we went.
It looked like we had it. Then we let it slip. And then we went into overtime.
Al used to stress, you play as you practice. And John Tinelli and I had done two-on-twos 100,000 times.
4-4 ties, 7 minutes gone in overtime.
And, you know, our defensemen never bit, but in this particular case, it just worked so perfectly because Lauren Henning intercepted the pass, threw it up to John Tinelli, and all he did was crisscross, and he got Bob Daly to bite. I was able to sneak by him, get to the net, and then Johnny just put a perfect pass on my stick.
The pass to
head was down between my knees, trying to catch my breath, getting ready for the next shift. And I just heard the roar of the crowd. I think I leaped over the board, something I probably never could do before or since.
Bobby's in the corner, and JT is all over him, and Lauren Henning is there. And there was this moment of, is this really happening? When I grabbed the cup for the first time in the Coliseum, and I turned around, that's all I had in my mind. This is the ultimate goal.
There were so many fans on the ice. Everyone was congratulating us. And to realize that this was something that you had dreamed about from being a young kid, it was thrilling. It was thrilling.
When Nystrom scored, we won the first cup on a Saturday afternoon, May 24th. I was in section 336 in the last row. I think my knuckle prints are still in the ceiling because that's how low the ceiling is up there. Now I get a chance to revisit this place with my son, this old barn that is louder than any place on the planet during hockey season.
Saturday nights at 8 o'clock, all of Long Island focused on this arena.
It was a family. After a while, your ushers knew you, your ticket takers knew you.
I can't believe after 40 years that it's not going to be here. I am bringing my grandchildren here now, so we have a good three generations growing up watching the game here.
Our broadcast location at that time was over one of the entries off the concourse. We got to know people behind us. We watched children grow up. We were invited, I know, to anniversaries, birthday parties.
They were a big part of the fabric of the community. You could go out and have your softball team play the New York Islanders in a charity event. That was a big thing.
There's a saying, if you haven't met Bobby Nystrom, you're not a true Long Islander.
There's no mystique about the guys that played on our team. We were accessible to the fans. I worked during the summer. So the thing is that I was out there.
Eddie Westphal and Billy Harris lived around the corner from me. We used to ride our bikes past their house. It was like, that's where they live.
My dry cleaner, he thought we were his kids. Once a year, he would have the same group of guys over to his house for an Italian feast.
Long Island became a second home to all of us. That's how close it got between us and our fans.
In 1980-81, the Islanders continued their championship ways, losing only two playoff games en route to another Stanley Cup final.
Beating Philly was a huge stepping stone for us to finally, you know, figure out how to do it. The next year, we played Minnesota in the final, and we went through that pretty easily.
The Islanders built a 3-0 lead on the Stars, but a loss in Game 4 presented the Coliseum with an opportunity to host a second straight Cup celebration.
It's all over tonight.
The home team came out strong.
Now here's Gordon.
Backed by Conn Smythe winner Butch Goring's pair of goals, the Islanders sailed to a 5-1 victory.
The New York Islanders have won the Stanley Cup for the second consecutive year, defeating the Minnesota North Stars.
You want to win the cup again because, boy, it was a great experience. And then you win the second one, and then you're thinking about the third one, and then you're thinking about the fourth one.
You want that feeling of being a champion all the time. And if someone was going to wrestle away from it, they're going to have to earn it.
Somewhere along the line, we all looked at each other and said, listen, if we come and play as hard as we can possibly play, nobody's going to beat us.
You could think you were going to beat them, but they'd find any way imaginable to beat you.
We weren't intimidated. We didn't feel intimidated. We wanted to intimidate other teams. Any kind of game you wanted to play, whether it was wide open fire wagon hockey, grind them, bang them, physical game, we're in.
New York won their third straight cup in 1982 and challenged the dynamic Edmonton Oilers in the 1983 Stanley Cup final.
Edmonton, they were going to end this Islander streak. They were a young team, fast team, but they just didn't have the finish when it came right down to it.
For the third straight final, the Islanders carried a 3-0 lead, and the Coliseum faithful were hungry for another Stanley Cup.
Bill Torrey put the perfect bunch of guys together.
Now with Tinelli in front of the net, score!
There's 16 guys on that team that won 4 Stanley Cups in a row. I mean, that's amazing.
We knew the first go-round how good they were. We wanted what they had, and they wanted to keep what they had.
people just started hating us. The Montreal Canadiens were winning 4 straight cups. People respected them, but they start to hate them because, hey, come on, let somebody else win the Stanley Cup.
New York won an NHL record 19 straight playoff series and appeared in a 5th consecutive final. But this time, the Oilers ended the streak.
We really learned a lot from their team and went on to be able to win championships because of our respect for them as players and as people.
Win 19 consecutive playoff series it's a record that's going to stand for a long, long time.
For 16 of us who won all 4 cups, there's a bond there that just doesn't go away.
The people were proud of the Islanders. It's their team. And we gave them 6 weeks of a lot of fun.
Well, that 93 team, to this day, we still stick together. It was a real young group of players, a young set of defense, 4 rookie defensemen.
But a lot of growing pains. Every now and then, it looked like the team could become cohesive, could be a factor.
Well, I don't think we had any expectations for the playoffs. We got in on the last day of the season, and I don't know that we had thought about the level jump that was going to happen in play.
This crowd stands to applaud the Caps. They have defeated the Islanders by a score of 3-1.
We lost the first game and really didn't play very well. We got on the bus outside our hotel, and Al kicked the bus driver off, closed the door, and just lit into us. What are we here for? Do we want to win this series, or are we just going to go through the motions? We needed a kick in the rear end. He gave it to us, and we responded.
They were a team that just didn't lose in overtime.
In game 2, Brian Mullen took a shot and was sitting on the goalie's pads, and I poked it in, and they gave it to Brian. And at the time, nobody even thought much about it. We won, we were happy, we come back here. And
the Islanders now with the pressure, and they've got the crowd behind them. All over in Norton, puck comes free, Hogue in front to Ferraro, score!
He wanted to score more than anyone. And him and Benoit Hogue and I played together. You know you're a good line when you come off after every shift and you're having like a verbal fight on the bench because you're pissed off at each other. That means you're there to win and you're not really that concerned about your own personal goals.
The next night, I don't even really know what I was doing on the ice with Claude Loisel and Tom Fitzgerald. Fitzgerald hit Loisel out wide. It went from side to side. I went straight up the middle of the ice and I was right in this far away. Tommy Fitzgerald grabbed me and kind of tackled me. And when I was at the bottom of the pile, the noise you could hear in the building, like literally it felt like it was rumbling underneath us.
The New York Islanders for the 3rd straight game win in overtime.
You win an overtime game and it's an incredible feeling. And then you win the next one. Then you win the next one and it's like, who's going to beat us?
New York couldn't close out the Caps in D.C., but dominated Game 6 with timely goals and clutch saves.
Takes the shot, great save, Healy!
After Pierre Turgeon made it 5-1 in the 3rd, Washington captain Dale Hunter punctuated his team's frustration.
That hit was the dirtiest plays I've ever seen in any sport.
Dale gave the puck away, and about 14 seconds after Pierre scored the goal, the hit happened, and immediately it was battle stations.
Oh, no. Pierre Turgeon, one of the best players in the league, is hurt by a nasty cheap shot from Dale Hunter.
We were such underdogs anyways that losing Pierre was just another quiver for us to deal with.
You could see the team just got together. And obviously, it was disappointing to be not being a part of the next round, but, you know, we won.
No matter what it was, we found the answer. We had no business, if you put the lineups on the paper, to look at side by side to beat Pittsburgh. But we did.
It was just a big, big family. We got on the ice, we really felt like every game we could, here it is, we're gonna win again.
Spring of 2002, New York returned to the postseason for the first time in 8 years.
It was probably one of the best playoff series that I've ever been a part of.
They're physical. They definitely were. They have a big, strong team, big lineup.
Trailing 2-1 in their first round series with Toronto, the Islanders got a boost from the Coliseum.
I don't think we knew how powerful the fans are going to be in this building. As you're lacing them up, getting ready just for a warm-up, you can start feeling it.
I remember noting in that game four, coaches were trying to talk to each other on the bench, and you could yell 1 foot away from your assistant coach, and he could not hear you.
It gives you goosebumps even thinking about it right now, walking into that ice.
The crowd energized the home team to take an early lead, but the veteran-laden Maple Leafs battled back and traded goals with New York all evening.
Jay Carson has tied this game at 3! Huge goal for the Maple Leafs!
With time winding down in the third, forward Sean Bates had a chance to break the tie.
Bates knocked down, that'd be a penalty!
I just got to jump on McCabe. One thing led to another, and then...
Will it be a power play, or will he point to center ice? It's a penalty shot! He points to center ice!
I asked him, you know, what was he thinking when he realized he would be awarded a penalty shot? He looked right at me and said, I thought I was going to throw up.
I went to the bench. Now all the guys on the bench are trying to tell you what to do, this and that, and you're not listening to anyone. There's one person I did listen to was Michael Pekka. He says, Batesy, don't try to deke in this ice. It's slushy, and it's gonna roll on you. And I said, oh my God, now I'm thinking.
That's gotta be an intense moment with the building as loud as it was and being put on center ice.
He got some advice from the captain, Mike Pekka, a moment ago. Here he comes. Bates against Joseph. Penalty shot for Bates. Bates in on goal, shoot!
Sean Bates scored that penalty shot goal, the Nassau Coliseum might have been louder than I had ever heard it.
What a moment of Islander history.
The fans were going crazy. It was a great shot, and it gave us a lot of life.
That was my most memorable moment. Can't believe I scored, you know, on a penalty shot in the playoffs.
An NHLer shows up at 19 years old, and for the next 13 years, he got the same coach. I can tell you one thing. There weren't a lot of things he didn't know about me.
There were certain guys that he'd massage all the time because that's what they needed. There were certain guys that he would boot in the rear end because they responded to that.
He just had a knack about saying the right thing at the right time or doing the right thing at the right time.
What puts a coach into the Hall of Fame is this intuitive understanding of human nature. And Al knew specifically after meeting you for 5 minutes what made you tick and what type of person you were.
Ted Nolan used to do his morning press conference outside the Islander dressing room where they have a mural to many of the great players and great coaches and great general managers that this team has had. Every day, Ted Nolan stared at the number next to Al Arbor that said 1,499 games coached, and he just knew it wasn't right and that he could do something about it.
I remember I got a call from the owner, Charles Wang. He says, do you realize how many games you coached the Islanders? I says, no, I don't have a clue. He says, 1,499. He says, we got to coach one more game, so you 1,500 with the Islanders.
Al kind of thought it was a publicity stunt.
I called Ted Nolan. I said, I got a call from the owner. He wants me to coach this one game. I says, look, I don't care if the game's in November or May. It's a big game. I don't want to cause any problems for you. He says, Al, you're not causing any problem for me because I think I'm the one that thought about it. I said, well, if you want me to coach that game, I will, but I need a lot of help.
There's a saying in sports that no one's ever paid to see a coach or a manager. That changes, at least for one game tonight.
He said, how am I going to coach them? I don't know their names that well. I don't know the line combinations. I said, just say line number one, number two, number three, number four.
That was just almost follow the plan. And then we go Comrie, then Silly's up next, and then we go back to Joe, and then we'll pop the fourth line in there once in a while.
Pittsburgh had one of the better teams in the league at that time.
Centering feet, Malkin, safety, Pietro, but Malone buries the rebound.
They got ahead 2-0 and figured, oh, my God, it's going to be 10-0 my first game back.
Who's got that first one here for us? Come on!
Al was real nervous at the beginning, but as the game progressed, and you could just tell he was getting involved with it, the players were involved with it.
Come on. Right here.
Crosby came back to pick it off. It carries back to Hunter. He scores!
Right there.
Josef Fasicek charges to the net, feeds Chatan, he shoots, he scores!
Yes!
Regular season nights don't come back to you too much, but that regular season night, anybody that was here that night, you know, will never forget that evening.
Art Carum held by Bergeron. Save, rebound, score! Miro Shatan! And the Islanders lead it 3-2.
We had a comeback victory. And honestly, it was like we won the championship.
Al Arbor is going to be a winner again.
After it was all done, I just shook his hand. He looked at me and I said, just like old times, Al.
Things haven't changed at all. You know, you have to win again.
It was symbolic. It was well-deserved. It was a salute to not only a great coach, but a great, great man.
We learned a lot of things from Al. Al was a father figure for us, probably more than even a coach.
They're chanting Arbor. If you get a good look at those eyes, they're going to be hard pressed to stay dry.
Al was a softie. He cared about family, and he cared about you as a person, and he cared so much, and that would shine through.
He knew your father's name, he knew your wife's name, he knew how many kids you had.
Al was able to take each player that played for him and, I believe, bring the best out of them and the most out of them and prepare them for what was in front of them.
A lot of what he taught us was much more than just about winning a hockey game. It was about how to be successful.
The general manager came over to me the next morning. He says, Al, you did a hell of a job last time, but today we got to fire you. Oh, God, I laughed about that.
You know, they really don't make them like this anymore. They're built for, you know, concerts and different venues these days. There's been so many games this season where you can't even hear yourself think.
In the spring of 2013, the New York Islanders return to the playoffs and challenge the heavily favored Pittsburgh Penguins.
I had thought it'd be hard-pressed for me to hear the Nassau Coliseum roar the way it did on Sean Bates' penalty shot goal. It was much louder than it was in 02, never mind the Cup years.
They just make it so uncomfortable for the opponent. It feels like people are hanging off the boards, the ceiling. I mean, it gets rocking in here.
Every time we finish a check, every time we make a play, the place is buzzing.
They just try to be as intense, as passionate as they can, and that gives us a boost of energy.
After losing Game 3 in overtime, the Islanders and their fans increase the intensity.
The Islanders pushed the Penguins a lot harder than a lot of people thought.
Bill, keep your head up, eh? Curtis been telling me he's gonna slash my teeth out. He's trying to get me twice now already. I only got one left, so.
It was an up and down game, and we were just a very resilient team.
New York scored first, but neither team could hold a lead. Tied at four halfway through the third, the Islanders looked to their MVP, John Tavares.
He's become a tremendous leader for our team. As he goes, we go. Johnny every day comes to the rink very focused, very determined.
The way that he focuses and the way that he prepares for games is second to none.
He's so explosive, he's so strong on his feet. His lower body is as strong as anybody else in the league, and you mix that with the skill set that he has in the hockey sense, I mean, that's a heck of a package.
Brad Boys forced the turnover, and I got the puck kind of at the top of the right circle.
Went backhand, forehand around Orpik and got his rebound.
I got the initial shot off, and probably should have scored on that one. I got the rebound and was able to put it in the open net.
Fleury the save, rebound, he scores! John Tavares has done it again! He gives the Islanders the 5-4 lead!
He's always scored big goals throughout his life. That was no different, that was a heck of a goal.
When I scored that goal, I remember just looking up into the crowd and just was amazed how much fun it is to be in that moment and have that opportunity to play in the Stanley Cup playoffs.
All anybody wanted was a reason to believe that this team had a chance to do something special. And to hear and seemingly watch the roof almost come unglued was an incredibly special memory.
Tavares, now captain, and his teammates have invigorated the fan base and re-energized the Coliseum.
Shoot and score! Johnny Rocket has won in overtime!
Oh, a monster hit! To Krabowski, they score!
before they moved to Barclays Center, a state-of-the-art arena in Brooklyn. The Islanders hope to give the old barn a proper send-off as they enter the 2015 Stanley Cup playoffs.
Every time you walk into this building, you have flashes of, all the good times.
The players obviously that he had know the tradition.
Do a lot of events in the summer with Clark Gillies and Bob Nystrom to see how close they are and how that's kind of made them all family is something pretty amazing.
It just shows, how much of a good place it is. These guys played years ago, but they all stay around. As younger players in the organization, I think you can learn a lot from people like that.
We have a pretty tight group here now, and hopefully we can win some Stanley Cups like they did.
You've seen us grow from being young teenagers or young adults, and a lot of us getting married now, having kids. And when you've come together like that, you share very special bonds, and we certainly have that in the locker room.
The tradition of this building, the tradition of this spot, we've done a good job of keeping this a great atmosphere.
It has a different smell than a lot of buildings. You get the organ going and all these different things that maybe you don't get in the new buildings now.
It's a homey feeling because of the fans and the people that you interact with on a daily basis.
Long Island, the Nassau Coliseum, I grew up there.
It's 40 years later now and got a lot of great friends. It's big town living, but your little pocket is kind of a small town just like where you grew up.
The team is the fabric of Long Island. When they talked about Long Island, it was Nassau Coliseum and the New York Islanders.
The building and the team is only as good as the people that are in the seats.
That's a very close connection with the people here. Certainly the team's grown up here at the Coliseum, and we try to do our best for them. Represent ourselves the right way and truly be proud to be an Islander.